Meat in South Africa is more than just a form of sustenance. It is a culture. Meat has been an integral part of global cultures and traditions since our first human ancestors started enjoying its juicy goodness thousands of years ago. Every human interaction, whether it be a turkey on the table or a plate of shisa nyama with a side of pap and chakalaka, we undoubtedly have a strong connection with our meat. Dozens of lab farms are currently developing cultured chicken, pork and beef with the hope of combating the impact of industrial livestock production on the climate nature crisis, as well as providing cleaner, drug-free and cruelty-free meat. A local food tech startup has mirrored this mission to pioneer their own variety of lab-grown wares.
And here we are cultivating the first meat in Africa. So we are working on doing a beef burger, and that's what we're going to be doing in the beginning. So that will be a beef where it's from cells from an animal, where the animal isn't killed. We grow the cells outside the animal and then create a burger. And ultimately, we would like to be doing other products such as chicken and lamb and pork and maybe even fish one day.
Cultured meat is said to have been painlessly created by harvesting cells from a living cow. Does this mean we have to head over to the lab, not a butchery? But based off independent research, it is beginning to look like Mzansi is ready to chew into the 3D chop.
But we're starting to do some, we've done some work with a partner organization that's looked at some research, and it seems to be encouraging to say that out of the South Africans that have been surveyed, this information is still needs to be publicly made available. Well, it is publicly made available, but reported on. Over half of South Africans said that they would eat cultivated meat when it became widely available. So that's quite encouraging for people like us and others who are looking at cultivated meat in the region to say that South Africans would consider it. I think that widely available is a key thing. So it needs to be on the retail shelves and it needs to be at restaurants. So I think that's our job to be done, is to make it available and accessibly priced. And that's going to come with time and with technological advancements. We've got work to do to get there, and we're confident with the team that we have and the team that we will grow to be able to do that.
This is not the only piece of synthetic meat making its way to our markets. Last year, US-based food innovation firm Just Eat got a thumbs up from the Singapore Food Agency.
When the restaurant in Singapore started serving, because they're the first ones to be able to serve directly to the consumer, the first couple of people that actually went to go try out the cultivated meat were younger people. It was a younger crowd because they're more in just their thinking. They are very inquisitive and curious to see what it is, you know, and they don't necessarily have a cultural connotation, I'd say, to meat. So this was, for us, we were like, okay, great. So now we're looking at, because everyone's got access to technology, everything is happening virtually, and information, a lot of information is available to people quite widely. So with the understanding of the younger crowd being more interested in cultivated meat, it just gave us a little bit of another perspective.
We savor the taste of meat, use it as the basis of social gatherings, and revere it as a rich form of protein. Its production, however, comes at a great cost. Livestock contributes to global warming through unchecked releases of methane, a greenhouse gas 20 times more potent than carbon dioxide. The increase in demand will significantly increase levels of methane, carbon dioxide, and nitrous oxide, and cause a loss of biodiversity.
It is true that livestock, you know, conventionally farmed, and especially in the factory farming setup, has got a huge carbon footprint, you know, especially even a water footprint.
Regenerative agriculture is a quiet revolution that is on track to reshape South African agriculture.
The regenerative agricultural movement has also got a role to play here. You know, that is a counter that we can use, in other words, to say, let's rather go this direction, but change our ways of farming, you know. And that's why regen agriculture has become a buzzword. And it's going to grow very, very, because we will never take the conventional livestock and crop farming away. We must just do it in different ways.
Don't reach for the cultured burger just yet. Cattle are a part of nature and could keep the system alive.
So on farm, we've actually got a full cycle, even a negative cycle, because whatever methane and carbon is excreted by the animals and nitrous oxide, we don't use, for instance, any nitrates on our, you know, our felt is natural. We don't use fertilizer to fertilize the food as well. So we've actually got a negative carbon footprint on the farm. Where the problem starts lying is loading the meat and delivering it to certain outlets which are far from us. You understand? That is the issue we're looking at.
But as science has evolved and concerns about the environment and global hunger have continued to grow, investment in cultured meat has hit an all-time high, and its biggest proponents believe it could be a game changer for the global food industry. With a growing population, we do need food that is produced faster. By 2050, we will be needing more food produced worldwide to feed the growing population. This chef is definitely ready to jump on the bandwagon to find new food sources.
So I believe that with such technologies, these are things that we need as mankind, because we eventually going to get to a state where we don't, or we cannot, so to say, farm properly, or the usual way that we used to farm. When you look at droughts, when you look at floods and all these other elements that play a role in our farming ecosystem. So us moving to cultured meat or cultured products is actually a good thing.
Several challenges remain when it comes to scaling up operations and bringing this newfangled food to consumers.
I think there's maybe internally hurdles that we have to get over. There are external factors as well. And then the perceptions that people have in general about cultivated meats. When it comes down to regulation, obviously you referred to it in the beginning, the Singapore government is the first government in the world to approve this cultivated meat for sale, which has gone on sale there. And it's governed by a Novel Food Act. There are a variety of departments and acts in South Africa that govern the food that we eat. And we are already working. I mean, this is something that we've been doing for the last 6 months. It's something that you should do in the beginning, as soon as you start any company in food, and working with regulators and showing that you are being transparent, and that you would, particularly with the new type of food, and how that kind of is seen by regulators and policymakers. We're definitely seeing the need to develop policy with government, and the regulations aren't there yet. And that's something that we will obviously, and our team will be developing with stakeholders, whether it's within agriculture, within health, within trade and industry, to create either an amendment or an additional policy that can ensure that cultivated meat is safe and regulated and available for consumers.
We may not see these meats for a while, but we wondered, if they did come to our shores, would a South African chef serve them at their restaurant?
I mean, it's only fitting. But yes, because I do believe in the product, and I do believe in the why we exist, you know, Mzansi Meat Co, and why cultured meat. So you definitely will be, because we want to be, and we are pioneers of cultured meat in Africa, and want to be at the forefront of it. So like, if I'm not going to back it up by using cultured meat, you know, and also introducing it in my restaurants, then why be in it? So I definitely believe in it, and we will definitely be showcasing it.
Honestly, yes. How I would look at it, I would look at as a division of two menus. You know, you'd have your cultured meat, and then you'd have your organic meat, which is what we are having currently. I would want to serve cultured meat because it won't be as expensive. So if I have huge traffic and I would like to, you know, utilize or just exploit the market by making more income, then I would go for that, you know, because at the end of the day, it's still meat. It comes from an animal.
While the large-scale livestock industry is viewed by many as an unnecessary evil, we see the global mushrooming of companies growing meat cells in culture to produce real meat without needing to raise and kill animals. There may be a few hurdles to leap through, but the Mzansi Meat Company believes it is only a matter of time until you will be ordering the cultured steak in local restaurants.
There you have it, Mzansi. Nolothando Ncakane for Food for Mzansi.